project your voice.
I'm Simi Kamal. I'm the chairperson of Hisar Foundation, which is a foundation for water, food, and livelihood security. We operate in Pakistan right now, but we are set up to work in the whole region. So when the floods came, one can't say that they were entirely unexpected, because we know about climate change. We know that there have been peaks and troughs in terms of floods and droughts. The climate scientists had predicted some time ago that in the Indian subcontinent there would be at least 50 million environmental refugees up to the year 2015. So now 22 million have already happened in Pakistan. People want to know how prepared we were to face this calamity. I would say yes and no. You know, the scale of the calamity is so big that I think nobody could have been prepared for it. Nonetheless, there have been some interesting instances. For example, dams and barrages have withstood the pressure, sometimes 1.5 times more than what they were designed to do. Civil society and citizens and the Pakistan army, everybody's come out to help. So one would say that when the earthquake happened in 2005, we got some practice. But the point is that at that time, it was rather limited. This is all over the Indus Basin. It's like 1,000 miles. And as the waters have flown, it's not been very clear where bits of water would go and where they would end up. So many breaches have been made, many poor people have suffered. And how are we responding to it? At Hisar Foundation, we have looked at the issue in four phases. We are not a specialized rescue agency, so of course we didn't go into rescue. But after that, we see our work in four phases. The first one is relief, followed by what we call maintenance. That is, you know, once people are either in camps or in some higher ground, you have to stay there for maybe 2 weeks to 2 months or 3 months. For us, that's a maintenance phase. Then we go on to rehabilitation when people start returning. And after that, there'll be a new kind of normalcy. We don't know what that normalcy will be. But then we have many opportunities to do things better at that time. So in the relief phase, we were just concentrating on providing safe drinking water, whether it's in bottles or coolers or jerry cans, we're just getting water out there. In the maintenance phase, we have gone much more for bulk water production. You know, with some of our partners at the Hisar Foundation, some of the engineering partners in particular, we have designed a very simple filtration plant that has four functions all together in one. There's no casing or anything, so it's very low cost. So there's chlorination, there's slow sand filter, there's charcoal filter, and there's UV treatment. So at the end of it, you just put one end of the tube in the flood waters, and from the other end you get drinking water. And this can produce something like 5,000 gallons per day, so 12,000 people can use it. We've attached some simple generators, and there's a fuel supply. So you can run it for more than 8 hours, you get more water. So that's basically what we're doing in this phase. So it's water for life that we're talking about. Once we get into the rehab phase, then we're talking about water for life and livelihoods. So at that time, we'll be working with women to ensure that they can do at least kitchen gardening. So there's some rudimentary food supply. And we'll be working with the family as a whole and with farmers to see that they start at least some subsistence farming. So that is, and at that time, we'll be talking of better water management, better conservation. Even though these were floods, we know that this is a freak incident. So people have to learn how to manage water better. And then we see what the normalcy is, what the new normalcy is. There are going to be many social changes as well, because some of the poorest of the landless farmers, they have arrived at the cities or around the cities, and they don't want to go back because they see it as freedom from the yoke of the big landlords. So there is an issue that some of them may not be going back. How have we worked on the ground? We have a number of water partnerships that are linked to GWP. So the Karachi Water Partnership is helping to look after some of the camps that are on the peripheries of Karachi. We have a Jamshoro District Partnership, and Jamshoro area is on the right bank of the Indus, one of the worst affected. So out there we are working with our partners. We've already got several of these filtration plants out there. Then of course we are working with Indus Delta Partnership, that is an old established partnership in Pakistan. Tata district, of course, is right near the coast, and it's one of the worst affected, because by the time the waters got there, it was high tide, it was full moon, so there was just nowhere for the water to go. And in addition, over the last few years, because the way we have mismanaged the Indus Delta, there is a seawater intrusion of 200 kilometers, which means that that water is going nowhere for a very long time. So, you know, that means diseases, it means people displaced for much longer periods. So it's a calamity that's put us back, you know, as a country by maybe a decade, if not more. So it's going to be really hard work, but then we got to move forward. There are a number of other ways that we are trying to address the problem. You know, women's issues, nobody thinks about their special health and hygiene needs. So that's something we're concentrating on, trying to get support for sanitation and hygiene goods and services.
And you're trying to raise money?
That is, of course, yes. We have, Hisar Foundation has raised an appeal for $500,000. And we are trying to get support both in cash and kind. Money's been flowing in, the in-kind support's been flowing in. Much of our support is coming from philanthropists and from businesses. You know, Karachi as a city has a heart of gold. It is known as one of the most philanthropic cities in the world. So everywhere you go, you know, people out there, from kids to old people. And in our own appeal, we have youngsters helping us, we have school kids, we have businessmen, we have women, housewives. And I think our youngest contributor so far has been a young kid who made lemonade and sold it in her apartments, and she gave us 3,000 rupees. But we feel that what she has raised is as important as the lakhs of rupees that somebody else is giving us, and we want to encourage this. So let's see, we have a whole lot of volunteers working with us. Hisar Foundation is a very interesting organization because it's a volunteer-driven organization. It is not a service delivery organization. It doesn't get funding from World Bank, ADB, or anybody, and we don't apply for projects. We have our own program, and we ask people to come in and support us. The governor, the governing body, as well as the council of members are very proactive. So we actually push and push the organization, and we set the direction. So, you know, everybody's on board right now, and we can only hope that we cope with this as best as we can.
Great. Thank you.